Biological fathers are usually excluded from abortion ethics discussions in the applied ethics literature. Usually it's focused on the pregnant woman and the unborn developing human, and all third parties, including the biological father, are usually excluded from the discussion. This is understandable because the mother is going to have to, and if she's forced to carry, will have to endure the pregnancy for 9 months. It can be medically risky, it can be emotionally draining, it can be physically exhaustive. And on the other side of the equation, you've got the unborn developing human, where if the abortion occurs, it ceases to exist. It's terminated. And so the stakes are very high, and so the discussion is usually narrowly focused on those two parties. However, we do see the biological father enter into the moral equation today in the emerging so-called right to the death of the fetus literature that is discussing and concerning whether or not biological parents would have a moral right to insist that an unborn developing human be terminated, even if it could be gestated outside of the womb in an artificial womb. This is where the abortion ethics discussion is already headed, proactively, before artificial wombs are even scientifically or medically available. Philosophers are discussing that now, and the interests of the father are entering the conversation quite prominently. They also entered the conversation back in the 80s, and I'm sure several different fashions, but one prominent article is Fathers and Fetuses by George Harris. I want to make sure his name was George. And Harris argues that abortions can undermine the autonomy of a biological father if certain conditions are met, and the infringement to the biological father's autonomy can be so great as to render a potential abortion impermissible, even if abortion were generally permissible otherwise. So he doesn't say this outright, but I think he takes for granted, or he assumes, that abortions in some cases are morally permissible. And then he asks himself, when would abortions so infringe the autonomy of the biological father that they wouldn't be okay? And he gives us five cases, and they run the gamut, and they provide a nice range of cases where it seems obviously clear that they would not undermine the biological father's autonomy, all the way to a case where it seems like the abortion definitely would undermine the biological father's autonomy. And you've got a range of cases in between to help us unpack our moral intuitions and make sense of them in terms of when autonomy is important, the biological fathers in particular, and how that would have bearing on the ethics of any particular abortion. The first case I call the repentant rapist. In the first case, there's a mentally deranged man. He rapes a woman, she becomes pregnant, and after she becomes pregnant due to this rape, he recovers. He seeks therapy, he receives medications, he is no longer insane, and he was insane at the time of the rape. The mother understandably wants to abort that pregnancy. She doesn't want to be reminded of the rape. She doesn't want to bear the offspring of this previously insane person. Has no interest in becoming a mother at this time, or even giving the resulting baby up for adoption, undergoing pregnancy for 9 months and all the risks and burdens that entails. She says, no, I don't want to do any of those things. But the repentant rapist biological father says, ma'am, I beg of you, please do not have an abortion. If you will carry the unborn developing human to term, I will take care of the baby. I will also pay for all of your medical expenses. You won't have to pay for anything. Please don't abort. And she aborts anyway. Harris argues that this was completely okay for her to do because when the rapist, even though he was insane, overrode the woman's autonomy and forced this pregnancy upon her, that was such an infringement on her autonomy, or her free will, her choice, her ability to plan her life and make decisions with full information, that he doesn't have any rightful interest in the unborn developing human. It's not a proper object of his moral interest, I think is the term that Harris used, the way he phrases that. So that's the first case. Your autonomy doesn't matter in this case because you forced the pregnancy on the woman. Second case, a couple meets at a party and they quickly become casual sexual partners. And they continue with this casual, this case I call Closet Catholic, the Closet Catholic. And these casual sexual partners, I gotta be quiet now because my kids are playing, or they're throwing hatchets behind me, which isn't very safe, but they promised me be very safe, especially since they're on video. You guys are being safe, right?
Yep.
All right, thank you. this closet Catholic from these casual sexual partners, what happens here is the woman becomes pregnant. And when she does, this is when the guy says, "I didn't say this before, but I'm a moderately serious Catholic and I'm very much against abortion. I think we should become married now." And the woman says, "No, I'm not interested in that. I was only interested in casual sex. That was the nature of our relationship. We are not getting married and I'm having an abortion." Harris argues that in this case, even though the man really wants the woman to go to carry the child to term, even though he wants to marry her and to raise the child, and even though I believe he offers, as did the recovered rapist, even though he offers to pay for all of this and to take full custody and whatnot, Harris argues that this isn't an infringement on the guy's autonomy to the extent that the woman would have an obligation to carry to term, because he did not divulge his closet Catholicism and his seriousness about pregnancy. If he had done this up front and the woman had continued their relationship, knowing that if she became pregnant he would have this strong expectation, then things would be different. In fact, they're different in later cases. But in this particular case, since none of that was disclosed by the dude, Harris thinks that it's reasonable to assume that both parties would assume that they would have no parental ties to one another if she were to become pregnant. It was purely physical. Maybe there's a little bit of emotion there, but there was no long-term commitment. That's the second case, the closet Catholic. The third case, I'm trying to remember the phrase I used for the third case. Aha, secret confusion, that's the third case. In the third case, called, not by Harris, by me, secret confusion, there's a couple, and they've been married for 5 years. And in this couple, the gentleman has made very clear that becoming a father and having a family is the most important thing to him. He doesn't care about his career, he doesn't care about sports, he doesn't care about cars, any of those things that guys get distracted with sometimes. His main goal in life is to be a family man. And his wife isn't so sure that she's committed to be his wife and to be a family woman and to raise a family with him. But she has not confided this in him. She's kept it to herself. She's kept it a secret. And so that's why I call this the secret confusion case. Well, she becomes pregnant, and she becomes pregnant right at a time when her career takes a very important turn, such that if she were to have to take off work or even be burdened by a pregnancy for 9 months, this would impact her career, and she has to make the decision. Do I care more about having a family at this time or the career? And she decides the career. And she tells her husband she's going to seek an abortion, and he says, "No, I've invested all this time with you, all this money, all these emotions. You told me, or you allowed me to believe, that you were similarly committed to having a family. You can't just go have an abortion now." He offers to her, as the other gentleman did, to take care of the resulting child and whatnot. She has an abortion anyway. Harris argues that the woman definitely is morally blameworthy because she did not reveal her confusion. And he argues that we all have an obligation to be forthright and forthcoming and upfront about our intentions when it comes to procreation, because both men and women do have a legitimate interest in procreating. And when we invest our time and our emotions and our energy with a partner under the assumption, the reasonable assumption in some cases, possibly in this case, that they would like to have a family with us, we've only got one life. And all that time that we spend with them is time that we would have if we had full and upfront information. It's time we would have spent with another partner, not with that particular person. And so this did infringe on the biological father, the husband's autonomy. But Harris doesn't think that it infringes to the extent that the abortion would be impermissible. He thinks that this is definitely something for which the woman is blameworthy. This is definitely something that she is guilty of, that she should have disclosed with them up front, that she wasn't sure about having kids with him. But he does err on the side of allowing her to go ahead and have an abortion, since he thinks it's excusable and understandable for her to have not confided him or confessed her uncertainty just out of fear of disrupting the relationship and whatnot. That's the third case. The fourth case is secret aversion. So third case is secret confusion. Fourth case is secret aversion. Secret aversion is just like secret confusion, except that the woman knows she doesn't want to have kids with this guy. Been married 5 years. Becoming a father is the most important thing to him. He assumes that his wife also wants to become a mother with him and to raise his family with him. She knows, in case three, she's confused, she's not sure. In case four, she knows for a fact she does not want to be a mother with this guy. But she leads him to believe that she does want to have kids with him. But when she becomes pregnant, she goes ahead and says, I don't want to have a kid with you. I'm sorry, I've led you down this path. And she goes and has an abortion. Harris argues that in this case, the man's autonomy has been severely undermined because the woman knew she didn't want to have kids with him and she was not upfront about this. And so therefore, this abortion is more highly criticizable than case 3, 2, and 1 for sure, and impermissible on those grounds. Case 5 is the gender avenger. The gender avenger is this crazy case that Harris calls the man-hater. And this lady named Anne, I believe, she has been wronged by men. She has read about the sad history of the ways, different ways in which men have harmed women over the centuries. And she devises this plan to exact her revenge for all females upon all men by seducing it. Some poor schmuck, his name is Mark, convincing Mark that she wants to have kids with him and wants to start a family with him, gets pregnant, allows the pregnancy, she maintains the pregnancy initially to pique his interest and heighten his anticipation, and then has an abortion and reveals her plan and says, ha ha, this is what you get, Mark, for being one of those evil men. I'm taking this out on all men. This is just your just desserts. In this case, Harris argues that it is completely clear that this was completely uncalled for, indefensible. It's a severe undermining of the man's autonomy, because she knew that becoming a father, just like in all the other cases, was very important to him, except for case 1 where the guy was the recovered rapist, where he was clinically insane and then cured. But in this case, clearly an unethical act and also an unethical abortion, an impermissible abortion, argues Harris. Now Harris, he considers the objection that, hey, these are some interesting cases, but what's really wrong here isn't that the man's autonomy is being undermined, but instead what's important is that you've had some deception, you've had this intentional harm, you've had this negligence, this failure to disclose your interests, failure to disclose your plans, failure to disclose your uncertainties. So it's not so much about autonomy. And Harris says, yeah, all those things are wrong. What makes them really, really wrong is they disrupt the man's ability to have a reasonable life plan, to be able to execute that life plan with people who are forthright and forthcoming and honest about their own intentions and their own goals, such that he can have his own wishes respected based on face value of what they've told him. And that's what it means to undermine a person's autonomy. And I probably should have said this at the outset. Our autonomy is just simply our ability to reflect and to form a life plan and then to actually act on that life plan. This is something special that humans have. Dogs can't do this, cats can't do this, horses and whatnot. They're basically instinctually driven. But human beings can actually plan their lives and they can shape their character. They can shape all sorts of things. And one of the things we can do is we can be serious about procreation and starting a family. And when we do this, and when we start a family with a person who has made it very obvious that, or they've at least led us to believe that it's obvious that they would like to start a family with us, when we invest our time and our emotions and our money and whatnot with them, and they're not as committed as they claimed, this severely undermines autonomy and therefore would render abortions in many cases similar to these details unethical and impermissible. Anyway, an interesting contribution from Harris. Hope you enjoyed.